Unit 1. The solid state. The vast majority of the solid substances like high temperature, superconductors, biocompatible plastics, silicon chips, etc. are destined to play an ever-expanding role in future development of science. From our earlier studies, we know that liquid and gases are called fluids because of their ability to flow. The fluidity in both of these states is due to the fact that the molecules are free to move about. On the contrary, the constituent particles in solids have fixed positions and can only oscillate about their mean positions. This explains the rigidity in solids. These properties depend upon the nature of constituent particles and the binding forces operating between them. The correlation between structure and properties helps in the discovery of new solid materials with desired properties. For example, carbon nanotubes are new materials that have potential to provide material that are tougher than steel, lighter than aluminium, and have more conductive property than copper. Such materials may play an expanding role in future development of science and society. Some other materials which are expected to play an important role in future are high temperature superconductors, magnetic materials, biodegradable polymers for packaging, biocompliant solids for surgical implants, etc. Thus, the study of this state becomes more important in the present scenario. In this unit, we shall discuss different possible arrangements of particles resulting in several types of structures and explore why different arrangements of structural units lend different properties to solids. We will also learn how these properties get modified due to the structural imperfections or by the presence of impurities in minute amount. 1.1 General Characteristics of Solid State. In class 11th, you have learned that matter can exist in three states, namely solid, liquid and gas. Under a given set of conditions of temperature and pressure, which of these would be the most stable state of a given substance depends upon the net effect of two opposing factors. These are intermolecular forces, which tend to keep the molecules or atoms or ions closer, and the thermal energy, which tends to keep them apart by making them move faster. At sufficiently low temperature, the thermal energy is low and intermolecular forces bring them so close that they cling to one another and occupy fixed positions. These can still oscillate about their mean positions and the substance exists in solid state. The following are the characteristic properties of the solid state. Number 1. They have definite mass, volume and shape. Number 2. Intermolecular distances are short. Number 3. Intermolecular forces are strong. Number 4. Their constituent particles, that is atoms, molecules or ions, have fixed positions and can only oscillate about their mean positions. Number 5. They are incompressible and rigid. 1.2. Amorphous and crystalline solids. Solids can be classified as crystalline or amorphous on the basis of nature of order present in the arrangement of their constituent particles. A crystalline solid usually consists of a large number of small crystals, each of them having a definite characteristic geometrical shape. The arrangement of constituent particles in a crystal is ordered and repetitive in three dimensions. If we observe the pattern in one region of the crystal, we can predict accurately the position of particles in any other region of the crystal, however far they may be from the place of observation. Thus, crystal has a long range order, which means that there is a regular pattern of arrangement of particles which repeats itself periodically over the entire crystal. Sodium chloride and quartz are typical example of crystalline solids. Glass, rubber and many plastics do not form crystals when their liquids solidify on cooling. These are called amorphous solids. The term amorphous comes from the Greek word amorphos, meaning no form. The arrangement of the constituent particles, that is atoms, molecules or ions, in such a solid has only short range order. In such an arrangement, a regular and periodically repeating pattern is observed over short distances only. Regular patterns are scattered and in between the arrangement is disordered. The structure of quartz, that is crystalline, and quartz glass, that is amorphous, are shown in figure 1.1a and b respectively. While the two structures are almost identical, yet in the case of amorphous quartz glass, there is no long-range order. The structure of amorphous solids is similar to that of liquids due to the differences in their arrangement of the constituent particles. The two types of solids differ in their properties. Crystalline solids have a sharp melting point. At a characteristic temperature, they melt abruptly and become liquid. On the other hand, amorphous solids often melt and start flowing over a range of temperature and can be molded and blown into various shapes. Amorphous solids have the same structural features as liquids and are conveniently regarded as extremely viscous liquids. They may become crystalline at some temperature. Some glass objects from ancient civilizations are found to become milky in appearance because of some crystallization. Like liquids, amorphous solids have a tendency to flow through very slowly. Therefore, sometimes these are called pseudo-solids or supercooled liquids. Amorphous solids are isotropic in nature. Their properties such as mechanical strength, refractive index, and electrical conductivity, etc. are same in all directions. It is because there is no long-range order in them and arrangement of particles is not definite along all the directions. Hence, the overall arrangement becomes equivalent in all directions. Therefore, value of any physical property would be same along any direction. Crystalline solids are anisotropic in nature. That is, some of their physical properties like electrical resistance or refractive index show different values when measured along different directions in the same crystals. This arises from different arrangement of particles in different directions. This is illustrated in figure 1.2. This figure shows a simple two-dimensional pattern of arrangement of two kinds of atom. Mechanical properties such as resistance to shearing stress might be quite different in two directions indicated in the figure. Deformation in CD direction displaces rho, which has two different types of atoms, while in AB direction, rows made of one type of atoms are displaced. The differences between the crystalline solids and amorphous solids are summarized in Table 1.1. Table 1.1, distinction between crystalline and amorphous solids. One side is property, next one is crystalline solid, and after that the amorphous solid. First one is the shape. Definite characteristic geometrical shape in case of crystalline solids, and in case of amorphous it is irregular shape. Melting point. In case of crystalline, it melt at a sharp and characteristic temperature, and in the next one it is gradually softened over a range of temperature. Third property is cleavage property, and in crystalline solid, when cut with a sharp edged tool, they split into two pieces and the newly generated surfaces are plain and smooth. And in amorphous solids, when cut with a sharp edged tool, they cut into two pieces with irregular surfaces. Next property is heat of fusion. Crystalline solids have a definite and characteristic enthalpy of fusion, and amorphous solids do not have definite enthalpy of fusion. And after that, next property is an isotropy nature, order in arrangement of constituent particles. In case of crystalline, anisotropic in nature, true solids and long range order. And in case of amorphous, it is isotropic in nature, pseudo solids or supercooled liquids, only short range order. Besides crystalline and amorphous solid, there are some solids which apparently appear amorphous but have a microcrystalline structures. These are called polycrystalline solids. Metals often occur in polycrystalline condition. Individual crystals are randomly oriented, so a metallic sample may appear to be isotropic even though a single crystal is anisotropic. Amorphous solids are useful materials. Glass, rubber and plastics finds many applications in our daily lives. Amorphous silicon is one of the best photovoltaic material available for conversion of sunlight into electricity. 1.3. Classification of crystalline solids. In section 1.2, we have learnt about amorphous substances and that they have only short range order. However, most of the solid substances are crystalline in nature. For example, all the metallic elements like iron, copper and silver, non-metallic elements like sulfur, phosphorus and iodine, and compounds like sodium chloride, zinc sulfide and naphthalene from crystalline solids. Crystalline solids can be classified in various ways. The method depends on the purpose in hand. Here we will classify crystalline solids on the basis of nature of intermolecular forces or bonds that hold the constituent particles together. These are number 1 van der Waals forces, number 2 ionic bonds, number 3 covalent bonds and number 4 metallic bonds. On the basis of crystalline solids are classified into 4 categories: molecular, ionic, metallic and covalent solids. Let us now learn about these categories. 1.3.1 molecular solids. Molecules are the constituent particles of the molecular solids. These are further subdivided into the following categories. Number 1, non-polar molecular solids. They comprise either atoms, for example, argon and helium are the molecules formed by non-polar covalent bonds, for example, H2, Cl2, I2. In these solids, the atoms or molecules are held by weak dispersion forces or London forces, about which you have learned in class 11th. These solids are soft and non-conductors of electricity. They have low melting points and are usually in liquid or gaseous state at room temperature and pressure. Number 2. Polar molecular solids. The molecules of substances like HCl, SO2, etc. are formed by polar covalent bonds. The molecules in such solids are held together by relatively stronger dipole-dipole interactions. These solids are soft and non-conductors of electricity. Their melting points are higher than those of non-polar molecular solids, yet most of these are gases or liquids under room temperature and pressure. Solid SO2 and solid NH3 are some examples of such solids. Number 3. Hydrogen-bonded molecular solids. The molecules of such solids contain polar covalent bonds between hydrogen and fluorine, oxygen or nitrogen atoms. A strong hydrogen bonding binds molecules of such solids like H2O. They are non-conductors of electricity. Generally, they are volatile liquids or soft solids under room temperature and pressure. 1.3.2 Ionic solids. Ions are the constituent particles of ionic solids. Such solids are formed by the three-dimensional arrangements of cations and anions bound by strong Coulombic electrostatic forces. These solids are hard and brittle in nature. They have high melting and boiling points. Since the ions are not free to move about, they are electrical insulators in the solid state. However, in the molten state or when dissolved in water, the ions become free to move about and they conduct electricity. 1.3.3 Metallic solids. Metals are orderly collection of positive ions surrounded by and held together by a sea of free electrons. These electrons are mobile and are evenly spread out throughout the crystal. Each metal atom contributes one or more electrons towards this sea of mobile electrons. These free and mobile electrons are responsible for high electrical and thermal conductivity of metals. When an electric field is applied, these electrons flow through the network of positive ions. Similarly, when heat is supplied to one portion of metals, the thermal energy is uniformly spread throughout by free electrons. Another important characteristic of metals is their luster and color in certain cases. This is also due to the presence of free electrons in them. Metals are highly malleable and ductile. 1.3.4 Covalent or network solids. A wide variety of crystalline solids of nonmetals results from the formation of covalent bonds between adjacent atoms. Throughout the crystal, they are also called giant molecules. Covalent bonds are strong and directional in nature. Therefore, atoms are held very strongly at their positions. Such solids are very hard and brittle. They have extremely high melting points and may even decompose before melting. They are insulators and do not conduct electricity. Diamond and silicon carbide are typical examples of such solids. Although graphite also belongs to this class of crystals, but it is soft and is a conductor of electricity. Its exceptional properties are due to its typical structure. Carbon atoms are arranged in different layers and each atom is covalently bonded to three of its neighboring atoms in the same layer. The fourth valence electron of each atom is present between different layers and is free to move about. These free electrons make graphite a good conductor of electricity. Different layers can slide one over the other. This makes a graphite a soft and a good solid lubricant. The different properties of the four types of solids are listed in table 1.2. Table 1.2, different types of solids. 1.4, crystal lattice and unit cells. You must have noticed that when tiles are placed to cover a floor, a repeated pattern is generated. If after setting tiles on floor, we mark a point at same location in all the tiles, that is center of the tile, and see the marked position only ignoring the tiles, we obtain a set of points. This set of points is the scaffolding on which pattern has been developed by the placing tiles. This scaffolding is a space lattice on which two-dimensional pattern has been developed by placing structural units on its set of points. The structural unit is called basis or motif. When motifs are placed on points in space lattice, a pattern is generated. In crystal structure, motif is a molecule, atom or ion. A space lattice, also called a crystal lattice, is the pattern of the points representing the locations of these motifs. In other words, a space lattice is an abstract scaffolding for crystal structure. When we place motifs in an identical manner on points of a space lattice, we get crystal structure. Figure 1.5 shows a motif, a two-dimensional lattice and a hypothetical two-dimensional crystal structure obtained by placing motifs in the two-dimensional lattice. A spatial arrangement of lattice points gives rise to different types of lattices. Figure 1.6 shows different arrangement of points into different lattices. In the case of crystalline solids, a space lattice is a three-dimensional array of points. The crystal structure is obtained by associating structural motifs with lattice points. Each repeated basis or motif has same structure and same spatial orientation as other one in a crystal. The environment of each motif is same throughout the crystal except for on surface. Following are the characteristics of a crystal lattice. A. Each point in a lattice is called lattice point or lattice site. B. Each point in crystal lattice represents one constituent particle, which may be an atom, a molecule, groups of atom, or an ion. C. Lattice points are joined by straight lines to bring out the geometry of the lattice. We need only a small part of the space lattice of the crystal to specify crystal completely. This small part is called a unit cell. One can choose unit cell in many ways. Normally, that cell chosen which has perpendicular sides of shortest length, and one can construct entire crystal by translational displacement of the unit cell in three dimensions. Figure 1.7 shows movement of unit cell of a two-dimensional lattice to construct the entire crystal structure. Also, unit cells have shapes such that these fill that whole lattice without leaving a space between cells. In two dimensions, a parallelogram with side of length A and B and an angle R between these sides is chosen as unit cell. Possible unit cells in two dimensions are shown in figure 1.8. A portion of three-dimensional crystal lattice and its unit cell is shown in figure 1.9. In the three-dimensional crystal structure, unit cell is characterized by number 1. Its dimensions along the three edges A, B and C, these edges may or may not be mutually perpendicular. Number 2. Angles between the edges alpha, that is between B and C, beta between A and C, and gamma between A and B. Thus, a unit cell is characterized by 6 parameters A, B, C, alpha, beta, gamma. These parameters of a typical unit cell are shown in figure 1.10. 1.4.1 Primitive and centered unit cells. Unit cells can be broadly divided into two categories, primitive and centered unit cells. A. Primitive unit cells. When constituent particles are present only on the corner positions of a unit cell, it is called as primitive unit cell. B. Centered unit cells. When a unit cell contains one or more constituent particles present at positions other than corners in addition to those at corners, it is called a centered unit cell. Centered unit cells are of three types. Number 1. Body-centered unit cells. Such a unit cell contains one constituent particle, that is atom, molecule or ion, at its body centered besides the ones that are at its corner. Second, face-centered unit cells. Such a unit cell contains one constituent particles present at the center of each face besides the one that are at its corner. Number third, end-centered unit cells. In such a unit cell, one constituent particle is present at the center of any two opposite faces beside the ones present at its corners. Inspection of a wide variety of crystals leads to the conclusion that all can be regarded as conforming to one of the seven regular figures. These basic regular figures are called seven crystal systems. To which system a given crystal belongs to is determined by measuring the angles between its faces and deciding how many axes are needed to define the principal features of its shape. Figure 1.11 shows seven crystal systems: cubic, tetragonal, orthorhombic, hexagonal, rhombohedral, monoclinic, and triclinic. A French mathematician Breves showed that there are only 14 possible three-dimensional lattices. These are called Breves lattices. Unit cells of these lattices are shown in the following box. The characteristics of their primitive unit cells along with the centered unit cells that they can form have been listed in Table 1.3. Table 1.3, seven primitive unit cells and their possible variations as centered unit cells. 1.5. Number of atoms in a unit cell. We know that any crystal lattice is made up of a very large number of unit cells and every lattice point is occupied by one constituent particles. Let us now work out what portion of each particles belongs to a particular unit cell. We shall consider three types of cubic unit cells and for simplicity assume that the constituent particle is an atom. 1.5.1 Primitive cubic unit cell. Primitive cubic unit cell has atoms only at its corner. Each atom at a corner is shared between 8 adjacent unit cells as shown in figure 1.12. 4 unit cells in the same layer and 4 unit cells of the upper or lower layer. Therefore, only 1/8 of an atom or molecule or ion actually belongs to a particular unit cell. In figure 1.13, a primitive cubic unit cell has been depicted in three different ways. Each small sphere in figure 1.13a represents only the center of the particle occupying that position and not its actual size. Such structures are called open structures. The arrangement of particles is easier to follow in open structures. Figure 1.13b depicts space-filling representation of the unit cell with actual particle size and figure 1.13c shows the actual portions of different atoms present in a cubic unit cell. In all, since each cubic unit cell has 8 atoms on its corner, the total number of atoms in one unit cell is 8 × 1/8 is equals to 1 atom. 1.5.2 Body-centered cubic cell. 1.5.2 Body-centered cubic unit cell. A body-centered cubic BCC unit cell has an atom at each of its corners and also one atom at its body center. Figure 1.14 depicts A. Open structure, B. Space-filling model, and C. The unit cell with portions of atoms actually belonging to it. And it can be seen that the atom at the body center wholly belongs to the unit cell in which it is present. Thus, in a body-centered cubic BCC unit cell, number 1, 8 corners into 1/8 per corner atom is equals to 1 atom. Number 2, 1 body center atom is equals to 1 × 1 is equals to 1 atom. Total number of atoms per unit cell is equals to 2 atoms. 1.5.3 Face centered cubic unit cell. A face centered cubic FCC unit cell contains atoms at all the corners and at the center of all the faces of the cube. It can be seen in figure 1.15 that each atom located at the face center is shared between two adjacent unit cells and only 1/2 of each atom belongs to a unit cell. Figure 1.16 depicts A. Open structure, B. Space-filling model, and C. The unit cell with portions of atoms actually belonging to it. Thus, in a face-centered cubic FCC unit cell, number 1, 8 corner atoms multiplied by 1/8 atom per unit cell is equals to one atom, and number two, six face centered atoms into 1/2 atom per unit cell is equals to 3 atoms. Total number of atoms per unit cell is equals to 4 atoms. 1.16 close packed structures. In solids, the constituent particles are close packed, leaving the minimum vacant space. Let us consider the constituent particles as identical hard spheres and build up the three-dimensional structure in three steps. A. Close packing in one dimension. There is only one way of arranging spheres in a one-dimensional close packed structure, that is to arrange them in a row and touching each other. In this arrangement, each sphere is in contact with two of its neighbors. The number of nearest neighbors of a particle is called its coordination number. Thus, in one-dimensional close-packed arrangement, the coordination number is 2. B. Close packing in two dimensions. Two-dimensional closed-packed structure can be generated by stacking the rows of close-packed spheres. This can be done in two different ways. Number 1. The second row may be placed in contact with the first one such that the spheres of the second row are exactly above those of the first row. The spheres of the two rows are aligned horizontally as well as vertically. If we call the first row as A type row, the second row being exactly the same as the first one is also of A type. Similarly, we may place more rows to obtain triple A type of arrangement as shown in figure 1.18a. In this arrangement, each sphere is in contact with four of its neighbors. Thus, the two-dimensional coordination number is 4. Also, if the centers of these four immediate neighboring spheres are joined, a square is formed. Hence, this packing is called square close packing in two dimensions. Number 2. The second row may be placed above the first one in a staggered manner such that its spheres fit in the depressions of the first row. If the arrangement of spheres in the first row is called A type, the one in the second row is different and may be called B type. When the third row is placed adjacent to the second in a staggered manner, its spheres are aligned with those of the first layer. Hence, this layer is also of A type. The spheres of similarly placed fourth row will be aligned with those of the second row, B type it is. Hence, this arrangement is of AB, AB type. In this arrangement, there is a less free space and this packing is more efficient than the square close packing. Each sphere is in contact with six of its neighbors and two-dimensional coordination number is 6. The centers of these six spheres are at the corners of regular hexagon. Hence, this packing is called two-dimensional hexagonal close packing. It can be seen in figure 1.18b that in this layer, there are some voids, empty spaces. These are triangular in shape. The triangular voids are of two different types. In one row, the apex of the triangles are pointing upwards and in the next layer, downwards. C. Close packing in three dimensions. All real structures are three-dimensional structures. They can be obtained by stacking two-dimensional layers one above the other. In the last section, we discussed close packing in two dimensions which can be of two types, square close packed and hexagonal close packed. Let us see what types of three-dimensional close packing can be obtained from these. Number 1. Three-dimensional close packing forms two-dimensional square closed packed layers. While placing the second square close packed layer above the first, we follow the same rule that was followed when one row was placed adjacent to other. The second layer is placed over the first layer such that the spheres of the upper layer are exactly above those of the first layer. In this arrangement, spheres of both the layers are perfectly aligned horizontally as well as vertically as shown in figure 1.19. Similarly, we may place more layers one above the other. If the arrangement of spheres in the first layer is called A-type, all the layers have the same arrangement. Thus, the lattice has triple A-type pattern. Thus, the lattice has AAA-type pattern. The lattice thus generated is a simple cubic lattice and its unit cell is a primitive cubic unit cell. Number 2. Three-dimensional close packing from two-dimensional hexagonal close-packed layers. Three-dimensional close-packed structure can be generated by placing layers one over the other. A. Placing second layer over the first layer. Let us take a two-dimensional hexagonal close packed layer A and place a similar layer above it, such that the spheres of the second layer are placed in the depressions of the first layer. Since the spheres of the two layers are aligned differently, let us call the second layer as B. It can be observed from figure 1.20 that all the triangular voids of the first layer are not covered by the spheres of the second layer. This gives rise to different arrangements wherever a sphere of the second layer is above the void of the first layer or vice versa. A tetrahedral void is formed. These voids are called tetrahedral voids because a tetrahedron is formed when the centers of these four spheres are joined. They have been marked as T in figure 1.20. One such void has been shown separately in figure 1.21. At other places, the triangular voids in the second layer are above the triangular voids in the first layer, and the triangular shapes of these do not overlap. One of them has the apex of the triangle pointing upwards and the other downwards. These voids have been marked as O in figure 1.20. Such voids are surrounded by six spheres and are called octahedral voids. One such void has been shown separately in figure 1.21. The number of these two types of voids depend upon the number of close-packed spheres. Let the number of close-packed spheres be N, then the number of octahedral voids generated is equals to capital N. The number of tetrahedral voids generated, 2N. B. Placing third layer over the second layer. When third layer is placed over the second, there are two possibilities. Number 1. Covering tetrahedral voids. Tetrahedral voids of the second layer may be covered by the spheres of the third layer. In this case, the spheres of the third layer are exactly aligned with those of the first layer. Thus, the pattern of spheres is repeated in alternate layers. This pattern is often written as AB-AB pattern. This structure is called hexagonal close-packed HCP structure. This sort of arrangement of atoms is found in many metals like magnesium and zinc. Number 2. Covering octahedral voids. The third layer may be placed above the second layer in a manner such that its spheres covers the octahedral voids. When placed in this manner, the spheres of the third layer are not aligned with those of either the first or second layer. This arrangement is called C-type. Only when the fourth layer is placed, its spheres are aligned with those of the first layer as shown in figure 1.22 and 1.23. This pattern of layer is often written as ABC-ABC. This structure is called cubic close-packed CCP or face-centered cubic FCC structure. Metals such as copper and silver crystallize in this structure. Both these types of close packing are highly efficient and 74% space in this crystal is filled. In either of them, each sphere is in contact with 12 spheres. Thus, the coordination number is 12 in either of these two structures. 1.6.1 Formula of a compound and number of voids filled. Earlier in the section, we have learned that when particles are close-packed, resulting in either CCP or HCP structure, two types of voids are generated. While the number of octahedral voids present in a lattice is equal to the number of close-packed particles, the number of tetrahedral voids generated is twice this number. In ionic solids, the bigger ions, usually anions, form the close-packed structure and the smaller ions, usually cations, occupy the voids. If the latter ion is small enough, then tetrahedral voids are occupied. If bigger, then octahedral voids. All octahedral and tetrahedral voids are not occupied. In a given compound, the fraction of octahedral or tetrahedral voids that are occupied depends upon the chemical formula of the compound, as can be seen from the following examples. Locating tetrahedral and octahedral voids. We know that close-packed structures have both tetrahedral and octahedral voids. Let us take CCP or FCC structure and locate these voids in it. A. Locating tetrahedral voids. Let us consider a unit cell of CCP or FCC lattice. The unit cell is divided into 8 small cubes. Each small cube has atoms at alternate corners. In all, each small cube has 4 atoms. When joined to each other, they make a regular tetrahedron. Thus, there is 1 tetrahedral void in each small cube and 8 tetrahedral voids in total. Each of the 8 small cubes have 1 void in 1 unit cell of CCP structure. We know that CCP structure has 4 atoms per unit cell. Thus, the number of tetrahedral void is twice the number of atoms. B. Locating octahedral voids. Let us again consider a unit cell of CCP or FCC lattice. The body center of the cube, C, is not occupied, but it is surrounded by 6 atoms on face centers. If these face centers are joined, an octahedron is generated. Thus, this unit cell has 1 octahedral void at the body center of the cube. Besides the body center, there is 1 octahedral void at the center of each of the 12 edges. It is surrounded by 6 atoms, 4 belonging to the same unit cell, and 2 belonging of the 2 adjacent unit cells. Since each edge of the cube is shared between 4 adjacent unit cells, so is the octahedral void located on it. Only 1/4 of each void belongs to a particular unit cell. Thus, in cubic closed packed structure, octahedral void at the body center of the cube is 1. 12 octahedral voids located at each edge and shared between 4 unit cells, 12 multiplied by 1 by 4 gives out 3. Total number of octahedral voids is equals to 4. We know that in CCP structure, each unit cell has 4 atoms. Thus, the number of octahedral voids is equal to this number. 1.7 packing efficiency. In whatever way the constituent particles, atoms, molecules or ions are packed, there is always some free space in the form of voids. Packing efficiency is the percentage of total space filled by the particles. Let us calculate the packing efficiency in different types of structures. 1.7.1 packing efficiency in HCP and CCP structure. Both types of close packing, HCP and CCP, are equally efficient. Let us calculate the efficiency of packing in CCP structure. The calculation you have to check from your book here. And 1.7.2 efficiency of packing in body centered cubic structure, and its calculation you have to check from your book again. 1.7.3 packing efficiency in simple cubic lattice. In a simple cubic lattice, the atoms are located only on the corners of the cube. The particles touch each other along the edge, figure 1.26. Thus, the edge length or side of the cube A and the radius of each particle R is related as A is equals to 2R. And the remaining calculation you have to check from your book. 1.8 calculation involving unit cell dimensions. From the unit cell dimensions, it is possible to calculate the volume of the unit cell. Knowing the density of the metal, we can calculate the mass of the atoms in the unit cell. The determination of the mass of a single atom gives an accurate method of the determination of Avogadro constant. Suppose edge length of a unit cell of a cubic crystal determined by X-ray diffraction is A, D, the density of the solid substance, and M, the molar mass in case of cubic crystal. Volume of a unit cell is AQ. Mass of the unit cell is equals to number of atoms in unit cell multiplied by mass of each atom is equals to Z into M. Here Z is the number of atoms present in one unit cell and M is the mass of a single atom. Mass of an atom present in the unit cell small m is equals to capital M upon Na, where capital M is the molar mass. Therefore, density of the unit cell is equals to mass of the unit cell upon volume of the unit cell. So, it is Z into small m upon A cube is equals to Z into capital M upon A3 into Na, or D is equals to Z capital M upon A3 into Na. Remember, the density of the unit cell is the same as the density of the substance. The density of the solid can always be determined by the other methods. Out of the 5 parameters, D, Z, M, A and Na, if any 4 are known, we can determine the 5th one. 1.9 imperfections in solids. Although crystalline solids have short range as well as long range order in the arrangement of their constituent particles, yet crystals are not perfect. Usually a solid consists of an aggregate of large number of small crystals. These small crystals have defects in them. This happens when crystallization process occurs at fast or moderate rate. Single crystals are formed when the process of crystallization occurs at extremely slow rate. Even these crystals are not free of defects. The defects are basically irregularities in the arrangement of the constituent particles. Broadly speaking, the defects are of two types, namely point defects and line defects. Point defects are the irregularities or deviation from ideal arrangement around a point or an atom in a crystalline substance. whereas the line defects are in the irregularities or deviations from ideal arrangement in entire rows of lattice points. These irregularities are called crystal defects. We shall confine our discussion to point defects only. 1.9.1 Types of point defects. Point defects can be classified into three types: stoichiometric defects, number 2 impurity defects, and number 3 non-stoichiometric defects. A. Stoichiometric defects. These are the point defects that do not disturb the stoichiometry of the solid. They are also called intrinsic or thermodynamic defects. Basically, these are of two types: vacancy defects and interstitial defects. Number 1. Vacancy defect. When some of the lattice sites are vacant, the crystal is said to have vacancy defect. The result in decrease in density of the substance. This defect can also develop when a substance is heated. Number 2. Interstitial defect. When some constituent particles, atoms or molecules occupy an interstitial site, the crystal is said to have interstitial defect. This defect increases the density of the substance. Vacancy and interstitial defects, as explained above, can be shown by non-ionic solids. Ionic solids must always maintain electrical neutrality rather than simple vacancy or interstitial defects. They show these defects as Frenkel and Schottky defects. Number 3. Frenkel defect. This defect is shown by ionic solids. The smaller ion, usually cation, is dislocated from its normal site or to an interstitial site. It creates a vacancy defect at its original site and interstitial site defect at its new location. Frenkel defect is also called dislocation defect. It does not change the density of the solid. Frenkel defect is shown by ionic substance in which there is a large difference in the size of ions. For example, ZnS, AgCl, AgBr and AgI due to small size of zinc 2 positive and Ag single positive ions. Number 4. Schottky defect. It is basically a vacancy defect in ionic solids. In order to maintain electrical neutrality, the number of missing cations and anions are equal. Like simple vacancy defect, Schottky defect also decreases the density of the substance. Number of such defects in ionic solids is quite significant. For example, in NaCl there are approximately 10 to the power 6 Schottky pairs per centimeter cube at room temperature. In 1 centimeter cube there are about 10 to the power 22 ions. Thus there is 1 Schottky defect per 10 to the power 16 ions. The Schottky defect is shown by ionic substances in which the cation and anion are of almost similar sizes. For example, NaCl, KCl, CaCl and AgBr. It may be noted that AgBr shows both Frenkel as well as Schottky defect. B. Impurity defects. If molten NaCl containing little amount of SrCl2 is crystallized, some of the sites of sodium ions are occupied by strontium 2 positive. Each Sr2 positive replaces two sodium ions. It occupies the site of one ion and the other site remains vacant. The cationic vacancies thus produced are equal in number to that of Sr2 positive ions. Another similar example is the solid solution of CdCl2 and AgCl. C. Non-stoichiometric defects. The defects discussed so far do not disturb the stoichiometry of the crystalline substance. However, a large number of non-stoichiometric inorganic solids are known which contain the constituent elements in non-stoichiometric ratio due to defects in their crystalline structures. These defects are of two types. Number 1. Metal excess defect and number 2. Metal deficiency defect. Number 1. Metal excess defect. Metal excess defect due to anionic vacancies. Alkali halides like NaCl and KCl show this type of defect. When crystals of NaCl are heated in an atmosphere of sodium vapor, the sodium atoms are deposited on the surface of the crystal. The chloride ion diffuses to the surface of the crystal and combines with sodium ion to give NaCl. This happens by loss of electron by sodium atoms to form Na positive ions. The released electrons diffuse into the crystal and occupy anionic sites. As a result, the crystal now has an excess of sodium. The anionic sites occupied by unpaired electrons are color center. They impart yellow color to the crystals of NaCl. The color results by excitation of these electrons when they absorb energy from the visible light falling on the crystals. Similarly, excess of lithium makes LiCl crystals pink and excess of potassium makes KCl crystal violet. Metal excess defect due to the presence of extra cations at interstitial sites. Zinc oxide is white in color at room temperature. On heating, it loses oxygen and turns yellow. ZnO on heating gives out Zn2 positive plus half O2 plus 2 electron. Now there is excess of zinc in the crystal and its formula becomes Zn1 plus XO. The excess Zn2 positive ions move to interstitial sites and the electrons to neighboring interstitial sites. Number 2. Metal deficiency defect. There are many solids which are difficult to prepare in the stoichiometric composition and contain less amount of the metals as compared to the stoichiometric proportion. A typical example of this type is FeO, which is mostly found with a composition of Fe0.95O. It may actually range from Fe0.93O to Fe0.96O. In crystals of FeO, some Fe2 positive cations are missing and the loss of positive charge is made up by the presence of required number of Fe3 positive ions. 1.10 electrical properties. Solids exhibit an amazing range of electrical conductivities extending over 27 orders of magnitude ranging from 10 to the power minus 20 to 10 to the power 7 per ohm per meter. Solids can be classified into three types on the basis of their conductivities. Number 1. Conductors. The solids with conductivities ranging between 10 to the power 4 to 10 to the power 7 per ohm meter are called conductors. Metals have conductivities in the order of the 10 to the power 7 per ohm meter are good conductors. Number 2. Insulators. These are the solids with very low conductivities ranging between 10 to the power minus 20 to 10 to the power minus 10 per ohm meter. Number 3. Semiconductors. These are the solids with conductivities in the intermediate range from 10 to the power minus 6 to 10 to the power 4 per ohm meter. 1.10.1 Conduction of electricity in metals. A conductor may conduct electricity through movement of electrons or ions. Metallic conductors belong to the former category and electrolytes to the latter. Metals conduct electricity in solid as well as molten state. The conductivity of metals depend upon the number of valence electrons available per atom. The atomic orbitals of metal atoms form molecular orbitals which are so close in energy to each other as to form a band. If this band is partially filled or it overlaps with a higher energy unoccupied conduction band, then electrons can flow easily under an applied electric field and the metal shows conductivity. Figure 1.33a. If the gap between filled valence band and the next higher unoccupied band, conduction band, is large, electrons cannot jump to it and such a substance has a very small conductivity and it behaves as an insulator. 1.10.2 Conduction of electricity in semiconductors. In case of semiconductors, the gap between the valence band and conduction band is small. Figure 1.33c. Therefore, some electrons may jump to the conduction band and some conductivity. Electrical conductivity of semiconductors increases with rise in temperature since more electrons can jump to the conduction band. Substances like silicon and germanium show this type of behavior and are called intrinsic semiconductors. The conductivity of these intrinsic semiconductors is too low to be of practical use. Their conductivity is increased by adding an appropriate amount of suitable impurity. This process is called doping. Doping can be done with an impurity which is electron rich or electron deficient as compared to the intrinsic semiconductor silicon or germanium. Such impurities introduce electronic defects in them. A. Electron rich impurities. Silicon and germanium belongs to group 14 of the periodic table and have 4 valence electrons each. In their crystals, each atom forms 4 covalent bonds with its neighbors. When doped with a group 15 element like phosphorus or arsenic, which contains 5 valence electrons, they occupy some of the lattice sites in silicon or germanium crystal. Figure 1.34b. 4 out of 5 electrons are used in the formation of 4 covalent bonds with the 4 neighboring silicon atoms. The 5th electron is extra and becomes delocalized. These delocalized electrons increase the conductivity of doped silicon or germanium. Here the increase in conductivity is due to the negatively charged electron. Hence, silicon doped with electron-rich impurity is called N-type semiconductor. B. Electron-deficient impurities. Silicon or germanium can be doped with a group 13 element like boron, aluminium or gallium, which contains only 3 valence electrons. The place where the 4th valence electron is missing is called electron hole or electron vacancy, figure 1.34c. An electron from a neighboring atom can come and fill the electron hole, but in doing so, it would leave an electron hole at its original position. If it happens, it would appear as if the electron hole has moved in the direction opposite to that of the electron that filled it. Under the influence of electric field, electrons would move towards a positively charged plate through electronic holes, but it would appear as if the electron holes are positively charged and are moving towards negatively charged plate. This type of semiconductors are called P-type semiconductors. Applications of N-type and P-type semiconductors. Various combinations of N-type and P-type semiconductors are used for making electronic components. Diode is a combination of N-type and P-type semiconductors and is used as a rectifier. Transistors are made by sandwiching a layer of one type of semiconductor between two layers of the other type of semiconductor. NPN and PNP type of transistors are used to detect or amplify radio or audio signals. The solar cell is an efficient photodiode used for conversion of light energy into electrical energy. Germanium and silicon are group 14 elements and therefore have a characteristic valence of 4 and form 4 bonds as in diamond. A large variety of solid-state materials have been prepared by combination of groups 13 and 15 or 12 and 16 to stimulate average valence of 4 as germanium or silicon. Typical compounds of group 13, 15 are INSB and ALP and GaAs, gallium arsenide that is. Semiconductors have very fast response and have revolutionized the design of semiconductor devices. ZNS, CDS, CDSE and HDTE are examples of group 12 and 16 compounds. In these compounds, the bonds are not perfectly covalent and the ionic character depends on the electronegativities of the two elements. It is interesting to learn that transition metal oxides show marked differences in electrical properties. TiO, CrO2 and RuO3 behave like metals. Rhenium oxide, RuO3, is like metallic copper in its conductivity and appearance. Certain other oxides like VO, VO2, VO3 and TiO3 show metallic or insulating properties depending on temperature. 1.11 Magnetic properties. Every substance has some magnetic properties associated with it. The origin of these properties lies in the electrons. Each electron in an atom behaves like a tiny magnet. Its magnetic moment originates from two types of motions. Number one, its orbital motion around the nucleus, and number two, its spin around its own axis. Electron being a charged particle and undergoing these motions can be considered as a small loop of current which possesses a magnetic moment. Thus, each electron has a permanent spin and an orbital magnetic moment associated with it. Magnitude of this magnetic moment is very small and is measured in the units called Bohr magneton, mu b. It is equal 9.27 × 10⁻²⁴ am square. On the basis of their magnetic properties, substances can be classified into 5 categories: paramagnetic, diamagnetic, ferromagnetic, antiferromagnetic, and ferrimagnetic. Number 1, paramagnetism. Paramagnetic substances are weakly attracted by a magnetic field. They are magnetized in a magnetic field in the same direction. They lose their magnetism in the absence of magnetic field. Paramagnetism is due to the presence of one or more unpaired electrons which are attracted by the magnetic field. O2, Cu2 positive, Fe3 positive, Cr3 positive are some examples of such substances. Number 2, diamagnetism. Diamagnetic substances are weakly repelled by a magnetic field. H2O, NaCl and C6H6 are some examples of such substances. They are weakly magnetized in a magnetic field in opposite direction. Diamagnetism is shown by those substances in which all the electrons are paired and there are no unpaired electrons. Pairing of electrons cancels their magnetic moments and they lose their magnetic character. Number 3, ferromagnetism. A few substances like iron, cobalt, nickel, gadolinium and CrO2 are attracted very strongly by a magnetic field. Such substances are called ferromagnetic substances. Besides a strong attraction, these substances can be permanently magnetized. In solid state, the metal ions of ferromagnetic substances are grouped together into small regions called domains. Thus, each domain acts as a tiny magnet. In an unmagnetized piece of a ferromagnetic substance, the domains are randomly oriented and their magnetic moments get cancelled. When the substance is placed in a magnetic field, all the domains get oriented in the direction of the magnetic field. Figure 1.36a. And a strong magnetic effect is produced. This ordering of domains persists even when the magnetic field is removed and the ferromagnetic substance becomes a permanent magnet. Number 4. Antiferromagnetism. Substances like MnO showing antiferromagnetism have domain structure similar to ferromagnetic substance, but their domains are oppositely oriented and cancel out each other's magnetic moment. Figure 1.36b. Number 5. Ferrimagnetism. Ferrimagnetism is observed when the magnetic moments of the domains in the substance are aligned in parallel and antiparallel directions in unequal numbers. Figure 1.36c. They are weakly attracted by magnetic fields as compared to ferromagnetic substances. Fe3O4 magnetite and ferrites like MgFe2O4 and ZnFe2O4 are examples of such substances. These substances also lose ferrimagnetism on heating and become paramagnetic. Summary. Solids have definite mass, volume and shape. This is due to the fixed position of their constituent particles, short distances and strong interactions between them. In amorphous solids, the arrangement of constituent particles has only short range order and consequently they behave like supercooled liquids, do not have sharp melting points and are isotropic in nature. In crystalline solids, there is long range order in the arrangement of their constituent particles. They have sharp melting points, are anisotropic in nature and their particles have characteristic shapes. Properties of crystalline solids depends upon the nature of interactions between their constituent particles. On the basis, they can be divided into four categories, namely molecular, ionic, metallic and covalent solids. They differ widely in their properties. The constituent particles in crystalline solids are arranged in a regular pattern which extends throughout the crystal. This arrangement is often depicted in the form of three-dimensional array of points which is called crystal lattice. Each lattice points give the location of one particle in space. In all, 14 different types of lattices are possible which are called Bravais lattices. Each lattice can be generated by repeating its small characteristic portion called a unit cell. A unit cell is characterized by its edge lengths and three angles between these edges. Unit cells can be either primitive, which have particles only at their corner positions, or centered. The centered unit cells have additional particles at their body center. Body centered it is, at the center of each face centered, or at the center of two opposite faces, end centered. There are seven types of primitive unit cells. Taking centers unit cells also into account, there are 14 types of unit cells in all, which result in 14 Bravais lattices. Close packing of particles result in two highly efficient lattices, hexagonal close packed HCP and cubic close packed CCP. The latter is also called face-centered cubic FCC lattice. In both of these packaging, 74% space is filled. The remaining space is present in the form of two types of voids, octahedral voids and tetrahedral voids. Other types of packing are not close packings and have less efficient packing of particles. While in body-centered cubic lattice BCC, 68% space is filled. In simple cubic lattice, only 52.4% space is filled. Solids are not perfect in a structure. There are different types of imperfections or defects in them. Point defects and line defects are common type of defects. Point defects are of three types: stoichiometric defects, impurity defects and non-stoichiometric defects. Vacancy defects and interstitial defects are the two basic types of stoichiometric point defects. In ionic solids, these defects are present in Frenkel and Schottky defects. Impurity defects are caused by the presence of an impurity in the crystal. In ionic solids, when the ionic impurity has a different valence than the main compound, some vacancies are created. Non-stoichiometric defects are metal excess type and metal deficient type. Sometimes calculated amounts of impurities are introduced by doping in semiconductors that change their electrical properties. Such materials are widely used in electronics industry. Solids show many types of magnetic properties like paramagnetism, diamagnetism, ferromagnetism, antiferromagnetism, and ferrimagnetism. These properties are used in audio, video, and the other recording devices. All these properties can be correlated with their electronic configurations or structure. Chapter completed. Thank you so much.